The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Hello everyone and welcome to this Marketing Solicitors Only webinar. Thank you for taking time out on this lovely hot day for joining me. Have a bit of sympathy for me. I've had to shut all my windows to make sure you don't get any background noise, so it's now quite warm in my unair-conditioned office. Just to check that you can hear me, can I ask one or two of you to raise your hands on the GoToWebinar taskbar? So I can check that I'm getting through to you, because often I've spoken for a few minutes before anyone hears me. Thank you, Sue. Thank you, Sonia. Much appreciated. Francis, John, Johnny, nice to see you there. Nice to see you all. Well, let's begin. I'll just move some things out of the way. More inquiries on your website and other things. I think one of the things that I wanted to share with you is about how to sell high-priced hourly rate services, which I've done quite a bit of work on with various consultancy clients recently, and I wanted to share the outcomes of that with you because I'm sure many of you, I know many of you sell higher priced hourly rate services, and there is definitely a skill to how you sell it. As always, there'll be plenty of opportunity for you to ask questions, so please make sure you make the most of this. Use the questions box. If something occurs to you, pop it in there, and at appropriate points during the webinar, I'll stop, answer your questions. If there's anything else you think of afterwards at the end, email me. But I'll get through as much as I can for you today to make this as useful as possible hour of your time. So what are we going to cover? The first thing is Umiditom, as I like to call it. And it's the biggest thing, and it only gets one mention here, but it's the first thing I wanted to mention because I want you to think about it all the time when we're talking about your website. It's enough about me. What do you think of me? And the biggest problem on most websites, and particularly solicitors' websites, although I'm sure not yours because you're all well-trained marketing solicitors members, is the website talks all about the website owner and how brilliant they are and what's in it for them in their business, but not enough about the client. So it's just something to think about whenever you're looking at your own website. Are you talking about the client? Are you talking to the client in user-friendly terms, or are you going on about your firm? If your firm name appears 3 or 4 times on the page, but you're not talking about the client's experience, then I'd say that the content needs some work. I think the figure must be well beyond 2 million, but that's you know what we've spent with our various different projects, first claims, loyalty law, everything else, on online advertising. So I think you know I've got a pretty good handle of what works and what doesn't. And the reason I often mention web marketing is because if you get it right, it will give you, and many of you, as many clients as you want or need. Some people say, oh, I don't really need a website. But it's the cheapest way of getting new clients. When you do it successfully, it can be totally automated, and it can make your life so much easier, which is why I'll always talk about it. So please bear that in mind. That's why I often go on about it. Sorry, just changing some GoToMeeting settings. What we're going to look at, more inquiries from your website, how to turn those inquiries into new clients, and that applies whether they're coming from your website or any other method, and how to get more of both of the above without having to do very much at all. First off, I wanted to mention marketing solicitors. As I always say, it is your marketing solicitors, so if ever there is anything you are unsure about, ask me a question. I'll happily answer it through a webinar like this or in a printed M4S if we're doing a printed one that month. You can ask it on a one-on-one basis by requesting a member call-in straight from within the private zone. When you log in, there's a button to send you off to set up a call with me. And I generally say one every 3 months, but look, if you're struggling, if you've got questions and you can't get past a certain point, don't sit there and worry. Don't sit there and fret about it. Get on the phone to me. Chances are I've dealt with the same problem or a very similar one with one of my consultancy clients many times over, so I can save you going through the pain of trying to work it out for yourself and get you straight to the answer. So don't sit there and worry. Set up a call with me, 20 minutes, 25 minutes. We'll get to the bottom of it. I'll tell you what you need to do to get past your blockage. That's the member call-ins. Let me know about future topics, webinars, anything you'll struggle with. And the other thing I'd say is, you know, use the Marketing Solicitors member group. If you've not yet joined on LinkedIn, do so. If you're on there, you know, Mark Cook's posted a question this week about payment systems. Only one M4S member has come back and given a response. I've always said I want to build much more of a community, and I think LinkedIn is the perfect format for doing that. And remember, the benefit of this as well is anytime you commit to a group or you comment on a group, your name gets put in front of all the people that know you, because that's how LinkedIn works. It's constantly building networks. So it says, oh, did you know Mark Cook's created a discussion here, and so-and-so, and Martin Smith's answered a question here. So it gives you a higher profile amongst all of your LinkedIn contacts. So there's all sorts of hidden benefits, but you know, make sure you use that M4S LinkedIn group. I want it to be a big part of the service for you. Right, with that housekeeping in mind, let's move on. I wanted to summarize the simple test you need to do whenever you're thinking about any marketing. And as soon as someone puts in front of you a marketing proposition, you have to think peacocks or elephants. Is this a peacock fanning its tail to attract a mate and using attraction marketing, which is far more effective? Or is it the elephant's slightly less subtle approach of getting straight on with the job? And that is definitely interruption marketing. So interruption marketing is newspapers, it's television, it's Facebook, where the primary purpose is not to look at someone's advertisement, it's to do something else, it's to read that paper, it's to watch television, a television ad comes up. So the chances of success with interruption elephant marketing are far less, therefore it costs you more to get the same results. Attraction marketing, being in the right place when someone is looking for you, the peacock method of marketing, is far more successful, costs you less to attract those leads, and that, of course, is things like your website appearing when someone types in, I need a solicitor for A, B, C, or D. You pop up, they go on your website, they like what they see, and they choose you. So always think, if someone's trying to flog you marketing, that I always remember from my days of practicing, and even now with consultancy clients, it's normally, oh, it's only £1,000 and you can sign up, and if you do it, it locks out your local competition, but if you don't, we're going to sell it to them and you're going to suffer because of it. 99 times out of 100, if they're having to sell it that hard in the first place, it's because it doesn't work. Let your competitor buy it and celebrate when they spend that £1,000, because it won't work for them. Those methods of marketing, run the peacock and elephant test and you'll soon be able to discount them and save yourself a fortune. So let's crack on with generating more inquiries. And there'll be some points you've probably heard me mention here before, but I'm always surprised how many times I have to say something before saying it in a slightly different way suddenly clicks or sinks in. So I'm not ashamed to say some things more than once. There's definitely a lot more new points in here as well. But the first thing is, tell people what you do from your website. Don't make them guess. I am still staggered. I must look at 20 or 30 law firm websites a week, and I'm staggered by how few actually say that they're solicitors. So you land on a website, first thing you see is the logo if you're lucky. Underneath that, I want to see the word solicitors, because it is a strong selling benefit for you, especially with all sorts of new entrants into the legal market. So you have to tell people what you do. Have any of you listening now just thought, oh no, I don't actually say that on my website? If you're brave enough, please type into the question box your URL and we'll go and have a look at it. And I'll need a URL in a minute as a test, so if you're happy for me to have a quick look at your website, I may well be able to suggest some improvements. Please type into the questions box your website address, and I will go there in a minute and have a look. But you know, that's a key thing. Make sure that you tell people you are a solicitor. Don't be bashful. Give me your URLs. We'll make it more interesting and more useful for you all if we start looking at some real examples. So please do give me your website addresses. Don't be shy. For those of you who don't have a website, that's definitely something that you should have a one-on-one chat with me about, because we need to fix that. If you do say what you do, the next biggest mistake and thing to fix is, tell me what you want me to do. Don't leave me to find how to get in touch with you. You need to make it absolutely abundantly clear on every page what I am to do next if I want you to be my solicitor. So again, come on, someone give me a website to go and look at so I can see if you're making this mistake. So far, nobody is pitching in with URL. I do want to go off and look at websites, because it just makes the webinar so much more useful, I know from feedback received previously. So type in your address or type in your firm name, I'll go off and find your site and we'll have a look at it. Otherwise, I'll just have to go into non-M4S members' websites, which won't be half as much fun. Thank you, Francis. Let's go to andreessolicitors.net. Oops. All right. right. Richard, there you are. Okay. Richardson's a coast, sorry. I'm trying to do three things at once, and obviously I am not equipped to do that, so apologies when I make mistakes. So we go up to this website, and what I'm saying is here, tell me what you want me to do. Obviously, I'm happy about this inquiry form, and I'll come back to that in a bit. But I scroll down the page. I've got to the bottom of this page, and the only thing I'm being told to do is to follow Richardson's & Co. on Twitter. Brilliant tool on here, which I very much like, which I'll come on to later as well, because it does work. Let's get rid of it for the time being. You haven't told me what I need to do. We've got solicitors, so step one is ticked off. But as I go down here, I scroll down to the bottom of the form. I might think this is the firm for me. I'm definitely going to give them a call. I get to the bottom, and there's nothing here. All I'm told to do is either go off to the FAQs page or to follow Richardson's & Co. on Twitter. I'm not told what the phone number is, how best to get in contact, if there's a free initial inquiry. I'm left hanging, and you don't want to leave any of your prospects hanging at the end of this. So the best thing you can do on there is make sure that every page, at the end of each page, there is a call to action which says, right, you're now here for a free inquiry, call us on this number, fill in the inquiry form, link to the inquiry form, get in touch with us in this way, and we will help you. So that is a major problem, and you know, you're not alone on that one. Please don't take this as a personal assault. As I say, I want to help and I want to improve things. So you have to say on every single page, what is it you want me to do? Someone said my voice is fading in and out. It shouldn't be, but I've just changed my settings. Is that any better? Can you hear me more clearly now if I keep speaking? Has it stopped fading? I've flicked to my non-wireless connection, so I hope that does the job. Excuse me. So the second thing is, you must on every single page tell me what you want me to do. If you remember that most people, when they're looking at your website, will only look at one or two of your pages and then they are gone. If you expect them to run around and look and find contact pages and inquiry forms, you are not going to get any inquiries. You will miss lots and lots of business. And it's these simple things that can dramatically change things. Thanks, Nick. Nick says I'm coming through a bit better now. Much appreciated. You know, I can't tell you, one Enquiries member, I had this chat with him, I looked at his website, I said, you've got no calls to action at the end of every page. He only had about 10 or 20 pages on his website. He went away, he made call to action changes at the end of every page, and within a couple of days, he was getting 5 inquiries a day. He did nothing else. He didn't make any other changes whatsoever to his website, except to add calls to action. And suddenly he was getting inquiries, and he was getting inquiries consistently. So if you don't think that applies to you, it absolutely does. Go off and make those changes to your website. It will make a big difference. The next thing you have to do is the two-minute trust builder. And this is something that I've developed, which especially works for solicitors, professional services, because you have just under 2 minutes on average. That's as long as someone will spend on your website to prove that you are an expert in that field of law. If they don't think so, they will be gone. So there's two aspects to the two-minute trust builder. One is proving that you are an expert by the depth of expertise. So that's making sure you have lots of pages about the service area in question and that each of those pages is deep enough for someone to work out what exactly it is you do. And I'll keep going back to Richardson's & Co. unless someone gives me another URL at some point. So let me come here and let's say if I'm looking for an injury solicitor, if I go to accidents, I can see there's 4 pages within this section. Industrial disease, there's another page, medical negligence. There's quite a few pages here about different types of work. So it's quite clear for me to see that Richardson's & Co. are the injury solicitors. The strap sign says so. It says they're solicitors, which is good. And there's enough content on each page as well for me to understand that they really do know what they're doing. I'm pleased to see on this page there's a call to action. What you will be missing here is a link through to an inquiry form, because some people will still rather fill in an inquiry form than pick up the phone and call you. We know that. As I say, I'll come back to that later. But in terms of the depth of expertise, this website certainly shows that there is enough depth for me to think this is enough. And I can't tell you the number of times solicitors say to me, oh, there's too much content on that page. No one will ever read it. Therefore, I'm going to get rid of it. And I'm going to make it much shorter, and then it'll be brilliant. And two problems with that. If you shorten the page, Google doesn't know what the page is about, so you've got absolutely no chance of getting free traffic to that site, because under 400 words, you're not going to be successful. And Secondly, if someone does land on that page, they think, well, there's not a lot of information there. Why on earth would I contact that firm? They don't seem to be experts in this subject. I can tell you that this is true because the only thing I managed to achieve of success of note for the last law firm I worked for over 11 years ago now, 12 years ago, was I left them with a beautiful website with a lot of pages, over 100 pages, and each one was beautifully crafted, of course, I would say so. But it was attracting a lot of visitors, and it was generating a lot of work for them. A year after leaving that firm, setting up Samson Consulting, I met one of the partners who'd taken over responsibility for marketing. He was very pleased to tell me, oh, Nick, I've got rid of that website you built, and so I've made it much simpler. It's now a 5-page website. It's really short and succinct, and you know, people can get straight to where they want to go, so it's fantastic. I said, oh, really? I said, okay, that's interesting. And obviously, overnight, those leads, your inquiries, stop coming in as well, and you don't get any work from the website anymore. How did you know that? He said. I know that because I've just done this so many times, and I can't tell you how many times I have to argue this point with solicitors and often M4S members who still fight it. Sometimes you have to let go of your own belief and thoughts and just take it on evidence of this is how I've done this with so many solicitors now. It's not just fluke. You know, first claims you might think has far too much content on some of the pages. I mean, look, you have to scroll down a long way, but you'll notice the call to action is repeated. At the top and the bottom, it's broken up with bullet points. Often there's an image on the page to break it up. And that's what you need to do to break up content for your audience. So that if they are skim readers, if they do want bullet points, they see an image, they see headlines, bullet points, they come down and think, yeah, that'll do, let's get on. So you please people that way. Out of interest, and this is kind of ironic, the two partners who were at the last firm I worked with now work at my longest serving consultancy firm, because sadly the firm they were in closed or got taken over due to lack of incoming work, and they're now working for one of my longest serving consultancy clients who generate most of their work from their website. So hopefully that's proof enough for you that, you know, what I say is based on evidence and fact. The second part after you prove depth of expertise is to proof of your expertise. Do you have qualifications? If so, shout about them. You know, if you're a member of specialist panels, law society panels, then put links to these, not from your website. Put a page on your website that talks about all the separate qualifications and proof of your expertise that you have, and link to that from usually the right side of your page. So, for example, on my website, you'll see I put down my Amazon book, I put down that's featured in the Gazette, Legal Exec, PCA, Lawyer. That links through to a page on the website. It doesn't take them away from the website, but it leads to what I call a buzz page, where they can see some of the articles, see the information. What many do is list a link to, for instance, Step, but then send me straight off to someone else's website from the homepage. Don't ever do that. Please don't do that. If you've got someone to your website, you absolutely must keep them on the website, keep them on page. Don't let them go off. So you can link off if you want to, but first off, go to a page on your website that features all of your qualifications, explains to the layman in layman's terms what that actually means, and allows them to read about it and say, okay, I can see that person's a professional, they've got qualifications, they've got relevant press coverage, they've had books or articles published on this subject, and volume helps, I'll come back to. The other proof of your expertise is obviously case studies and testimonials, people that have already used your service and know that you're, and therefore you can show others that you're good at what you do. I put testimonials all there because one of the things I'm going to start testing is changing the word testimonials to reviews, because if you think about the most common websites and the most accessed websites and the terminology that people are used to, it's reviews of products or services. Amazon and TripAdvisor have reviews. So I think it's going to be worth testing that. And you might say, well, solicitor's a service, it's not a product. But it's just the word review is being far more, and the public is very aware of it. You know, rated people, and all of these sites use reviews to justify their service, and so I think it might be worth testing that for legal services as well. And the final point at the bottom is volume helped. You know, if you've helped a lot of people, if you've completed a lot of types of matters, it's probably worth mentioning that if you've completed 1,000 wills, 10,000 wills, you know, that volume is another. It's not the only thing. I mean, you could complete 10,000 wills and not be very good at it. It's unlikely, because by doing that much work, you are going to gain expertise. But it's worth putting that on there, and I do that certainly on first claims. And you'll notice on your website, Genie, that we have at the top number of inquiries handled for our clients as well, because the numbers do help. Just say, okay, well, look, they must be doing something right if they've helped that many people. Okay, so does your website pass this two-minute trust builder site test? If I land on your site, does it make a big difference? Tim says, I'm fading in and out. I'm struggling with this because I've got two links. It's a 30 megabyte download speed. I'm really not sure why that would be the case, and I can't change any other settings apart from those I have already tried, and I'm on a good boom mic. So I'll keep going. All I can say is this will be recorded, and the recording is done through the desktop, so that should be clear. So if you miss any bits, please do come back and watch the recording, which I'll post in the zone. But 2 minute trust builder, is that working here? If I come here, what our clients say is, so we've got feedback and we've got 10 out of 10, which is great. We've got a link to testimonials. Probably the only thing we haven't got, we've got depth of content, but we haven't got any proof of external endorsements such as Law Society personal injury panel or press coverage or any other information. So that would be worth adding along with case studies. The next thing is to sell me onto your website. So if someone wants to type into the questions box a search term you might use to find your legal service. So type in something that someone looking for you on Google might go in and type. And I want to do a little exercise and just show you why what's behind the scenes is important and show you how you can tweak it. So come on, someone give me a type of service that you provide. And let me type that into Google so I can show you some behind the scenes activity of what your users, what your clients see and why you need to sell them onto the website. So thank you for that. Sonia, if I go fixed, I can type it, fixed fee divorce solicitor. Let's type that in. Now, these are Google's results. The first three here at the top and down the right hand side are Google AdWords. So I'm not looking at those at the moment. What I'm looking at are the search terms down the left-hand side, or the search results. And these results displayed come by what Stevensons have typed at the back of their website. So I've typed in fixed fee divorce, and excellent. What's at the top here says fixed fee divorce. That's their title tag. And there's lots of help about this in specific M4S issues. So I won't go into the details, but I want to show you why it's important that you draft this correctly to get people to click through, because just because you appear in Google's results, which is great, you might think that's work done. That is not enough. If you do not do this next step of making these tags right, you will be overlooked. So, for instance, if we can find a bad example, let's look at Jacobs and Reeves. So I've typed in fixed fee divorce solicitor. The first thing that shows in their listing is Jacobs and Reeves divorce fee solicitors offer a fixed fee divorce. And they put too many characters in, so it doesn't even show the whole listing. And again, they've got Jacobs and Reeves in their description tag, which means twice I can see their firm name. And what did I say at the beginning of this? Enough about me. What do you think of me? All they're doing is talking about their firm name. This is their sales space. This is their advertising banner to get me to click from a search I've completed in Google to go through to their website and take action and choose them as my solicitor. But because they haven't got a title tag which matches my search term, and because their description tag is poor, that's not going to happen. So if I click through to this page, which doesn't cost them because it's an organic listing, there's definitely depth of content there. Some might say too much. There's absolutely no call to action. So that means they'll be missing loads of inquiries, which is great for you because I don't think they're an M4S member. But if I show you behind the scenes their title tag, that's what we saw in Google's results, because that comes from this title tag position. Jacobs and Reeves divorce solicitors offer a fixed fee divorce scheme. Didn't even see the end of that because it was too long. And their description tag here, again, started off with their firm's name. Now, they are in position, what was it, 6 in Google? And I can guarantee, because of that poorly drafted title tag and search term, they will not be getting many clicks. So if someone does manage to go past these and the Guardian, okay, it's not a money-making site, it's not a lawyer, so we're not going to click that. But if we get past these first four and think, well, Slater and Gordon, they seem to be massive, so I'm probably not going there. I'll go to Jacobs Reeve. Well, I won't, because their sales pitch to get me onto their site is too poor. So you have to sell me onto your website. You have to take me from, if you're lucky enough to get to the top of Google, you have to make sure I click through to your website. And most people fail to take the step of writing the right title tags and description tags that will do that. So I want you to have a look at that. I'm going to show you analytics in a moment so you can see what people are landing on your site by searching. I'll show you how you find that information, and then you can go back to those pages and improve your sales copy to get me to click through to that site. So thank you for that, Sonia. That was a really useful example. As I said, my keyword tricks, I want you to see what I use to find out how people are landing on my site and to give me ideas for blog posts and article titles. So I'm going to show you that now. I'm going to run a little tool as well, which is free, which I'll take you through. If one of you could type in a URL of one of your competitors, this is a law firm that keeps popping up whenever you're looking for one of your core services that gets on your nerves and you think, I wish I was at the top of Google as many times as they are. Type in a URL for one of your competitors, and the next tool I'm going to use, Screaming Frog, I'll run an exercise which I enjoy running because it's quite interesting, and you might find some ideas for pages, for content that you can use for your own website. So someone give me a competitor's URL. No one's typed one in yet, so please go ahead and do that. First of all, I said I'd take you through analytics. I want to show you what I do to generate find search terms and see how people are finding my website. So the first thing you do as you land in your analytics thing is you want to change the date range. So I want to get a big period, so I'll go back and I'll do this for the whole of the year to date, and I'll click apply. Someone's given me a URL, thank you, I'll come to that in a minute. So you'll see it shows the number of sessions served. If I go to acquisition and then keywords and then organic, this is what people have typed into Google to find me. You're not surprised to see that my firm name is up there. But if I change this to 5,000, just to show rows, this gives me what people have typed to find my website. And if I go then to things like how many law firms in the UK, how to get personal injury clients, how to set up a solicitor, you'll find all sorts of search terms. If I choose how to set up a solicitor and I go across to one of my Google tabs and type in that search, it will show me where I've appeared in Google, and you'll see I'm right down the bottom. You'll see I've linked my Google account, so an image shows. Now, you might think that's a bad thing with that face, but I always think something is better. You look at everything else on this page, there's no images, and we know that images get people to click through, so it has made a big difference here. So you'll see I'm there. You'll see leading capitals in my headline, and you'll see a tag which I know because it's a blog, it's taken from some of the text in my blog post as opposed to the description tag. But what I can see is I'm in position 10 and how to set up a solicitor isn't the title of that blog. So what I would do now is say, okay, well, if I'm in position 10 but I'm not answering that question, there's two things I could do. I can tweak the content on this blog post to answer the question how to set up as a solicitor. But I would say, as I'm already targeting setting up a law firm or solicitor's practice, what I'd be better off doing is writing a new blog answering the question how to set up as a solicitor. Because it's a very specific question, I am almost certain to get to the top of Google or close to the top of Google, and I can answer that question I can match the answer to that question very well, and suddenly I'll get more traffic because I'll be higher up in Google, and the question answers the users. The answer will be there for the user when they type in how to set up a solicitor. So that's something I could do, and it's something I recommend you do every couple of months. Go through the last 6 months of your traffic, see what people typed in, see what the question they asked and where you appeared in the search results. So I was in position 10. Think, okay, well, that blog didn't answer the question. If I do a blog about how to set up a solicitor, then I can answer that question. I'll likely appear much higher up the charts, and I'll get better results. So I strongly recommend that you do do that for your own business. Every couple of months I diarize to do that, just to get a whole stack of blog ideas, titles for blogs, which I can then go and write about to get more free traffic to my website, because blogging is one of the best ways to do that. The other tool I mentioned for this is, let me just read some of those questions. Someone said, what are these not set? The where is it? Can I find one on here? Google does a lot of NP. Not showing up on here. MP, please verify. So when you see MP in front of a blog, it means the user, when they were searching, is typed in, is logged into their Google account. And Google then says, right, we're not going to reveal their privacy settings. We're not going to reveal what they searched in. We're not going to tell people how they found your site. So it starts taking out this data, which is really frustrating because it means you're not going to get, you're not going to know what some people are typing in. So it's I think that's the same for not set, Johnny. But I will check that and come back to you. Let me make a note. But I think it's one of the same reasons that it's not recording what they've typed in and that it was doing it as MP. But I think it's now, if you're logged into your Google account, you go and do a search, Google doesn't share what search terms you typed into Google with analytics, which is a real pain because it makes the software less valuable. Okay, I said there's another tool as well, which is Screaming Frog, which I have open here. Someone's given me a website. Almond Personal Injury Solicitors.co.uk. So this is Screaming Frog. As I said, it's a free tool to download. You can type in the URL, you click Start, and this Screaming Frog acts like the Google Spider or the Bing or Yahoo Spider. It goes off and starts reading every page on this website and starts having a look through it and seeing what the website's all about. Once it's running, you'll see it says it's filter total here, it's running through all the pages on the site up to 120. So it's a good site, it's got plenty of pages on it. I'm just going to take a quick look at one. So if I go to filter HTML, so it just shows me pages on the website, and we'll look at the first one, which is the home page. It instantly gives you your title tags, so you can see what each page is targeting, and then it gives you your description tag, so you can see what they've written there. I mean, what I'd be doing if I was if this was my website, I'd be changing these description tags to leading capitals for each of the words because it just stands out so much better in Google. When you type in, when you see leading capitals, it makes the ads stand out. When you've got an image next to it as well, anything you can do to get people to click through, which is what we're trying to achieve here, is a massive thing. If we scroll across, we go to keyword you don't need to worry about now because it really doesn't have any value. But if we go across to H1.1, you'll see what they've done here is they're actually missing a massive opportunity. The H1 tag is your title tag on the page. So if we go to one of the pages we had open here, the H1 tag on this page would be this long one here, which may well be too long. But it's where you put your keywords you're targeting for this page. And on Screaming Frog, you can see that they've just got "We're here to help, no in, no fee." It's not relevant to the page. It should match the title tag you're targeting, what's in your description tag. The keyword should run through all of these things. So you can see there that instantly it shows you there's opportunities. But in terms of ideas for content, you can see there's lots of different pages here. Beauty, treatment, injury, cycling, accident claims. It gives you lots of different ideas for pages. And this is exactly what Google sees for this site. So if you think, oh, that's a good idea, you know, away you go, you are on. Can you give me a hands up if you're still hearing me? Someone says they're struggling to hear me. Can anyone hear me? Yes, lots of hands up. So hopefully it means my connection's okay. And the problem might be at your end because the majority of people have raised their hands. Thank you so much for doing that. Much appreciated. If you're struggling to hear me, it must mean sadly that the problem is at your end. Which is good for me, not so good for you, but as I say, the replay will be made available. So Screaming Frog, free download, recommend you do that. Run it through your own site because you can instantly see where you're missing title tags, where you're missing description tags, and H1 tags. And what you might find often on blog settings, the H1.1 is set to be a default your firm name, which you definitely don't want to happen because that means Google thinks, oh, they're only targeting their firm name. I won't send any traffic to that page. You don't want that to be the case, so you can change your blog settings to get away from that. So don't make those mistakes. So there's some good ideas for you to go off and find content ideas, a great tool for you to use to go through and to get some new blog ideas and titles for your website. So I recommend you give those a go. The next thing I want to do is talk about Steve Jobs. He was a marketing genius. I think that was his biggest skill, and he understood what people would like and what they'd be excited about. He was not without huge flaws, and I don't think anyone would like to work with him, but he certainly got marketing. And one of the tricks he's used, which I've been using now for some months, which works very well, is just the Apple way of doing things. So I've got their HD. Now, we all know what high definition is, and it's a screen, and resolution's good, and it's going to give you a lovely picture, and you're going to see crystal clear and colors, and it's going to be a beautiful experience. But what Steve Jobs said is, well, we're not going to call it HD. We're going to call that Retina display. So HD for Apple is Retina display. Suddenly, they've got their own name for something that everyone else is calling HD, Sony, and all the other computer manufacturers. Oh, it's HD. Not for Apple. It's Retina display. So, that sounds great. I need that. I need Retina display. All the other people that provide phones and laptops and tablets call it, they have programs. No, not Apple. They have apps. Apple create apps. And suddenly everyone uses the term apps, and apps are exciting. Apps make you happy. Apps fill your day with joy. Apps are a great thing. So much more sexier than programs. Programs, dull computers. Think ponytail. Think long hair. Think generalizations, Nick. And then my favorite one, my personal favorite, is video call. Video call's been around for years. Not very exciting. No one liked video call. Suddenly we call it FaceTime, and the whole world wants to FaceTime. My kids have no idea what a video call is, but they know how to FaceTime me, normally at the most inappropriate times. So thankfully they're at school at this moment in time, so that's not likely to happen. But FaceTime is... it's just video calls. That's all it is. But suddenly you're doing it on your phone. It's much more exciting. The point for you here is you need to use this trick in your business. And certainly I have done, because I used to just say one of the best ways I make connections with people and can help them fastest is to get them on the telephone. But one of the things that I have an inherent weakness for is you know, chasing people to set up time to talk. And I don't do random calls because I schedule my day so that I'm getting stuff done. So I use an automatic diary booking system, and I send people off to choose a time for my online diary, just like if you're doing an M4S member call, and they get scheduled into a diary. And that's great. I used to say, you know, have a free call with me. And that worked okay, but once I named it have a more client strategy call with me, suddenly a lot more people sign up for it, because they get what they want is more clients, and they're going to have a strategy call with me showing exactly how they're going to get that. So for you, if you offer a free call or free initial consultation, know, give it a name that is unique to your business. Don't do what everyone else does and just call it have a free call. Call it a free client review call if it's for an existing client. Call it a move faster call if it's for a conveyancing transaction. Call it a lifetime planning call if it's for wills, or if you like, you know, if you want to be totally different, go straight for the jugular and call it a death time planning call. But call it something, probably not that. Call it something that makes them think, oh, that sounds good. Okay, and it's free. Yeah, great. I'll have a lifetime planning call. I could do with that. I certainly don't know what I could do. Haven't got a will. Haven't done the things I need to do. So give it a name and make it something that is unique to you, and you'll get a much better response than just selling a free inquiry or a free call. So it's something I've done for Samson Consulting, and as I talk to you now, I'm thinking I probably haven't done it enough for the other businesses like First Claims. So something I need to work on. It's definitely worth spending some time doing. The other thing I touched on earlier is the inquiry form. And so many firms I still see, and certainly M4S members, have an inquiry form, but it's hidden away. It's not on every page of the website, which it should be. And even if it's on the contact page, it's said, you know, if you want to get in touch, contact us. Well, coming back to the contact us, that sounds a bit formal, a bit dull. You know, make your free inquiry is better than just contact us. So if you do have an inquiry form, the most important thing is to make sure it's linked on each page, or is on the right side of each page. So in that position, have a button going through to it, even if you don't have it on each page. Put a button there, make a free inquiry, click here, send me off to the inquiry form. Or if it is on every page, have it in that position, which is perfect. Certainly when we did that for First Claims, that's when we started getting a lot more inquiries. You know, First Claims I refer to a lot. The reason is because it just converts inquiries much better than any other website I see. So if it works well, I should be sharing those results with you, which is exactly what I do. So you need an inquiry form, and you need to refer to that, as we do on first claims, at the bottom of every page, even though this stays on the right-hand side, our inquiry form. So you might think, why bother linking to it? I can tell you about 20 or 30% of our inquiries come from people clicking through to the inquiry form, and it's a long form, you would admit. 20 or 30% come from here, even though the inquiry form is on every page. They will still go off and fill in these details, okay? So if they're doing that, it's because they're happy to do that. So don't take away that option for them. Yes, we have the phone number that they can click to call from a mobile, and I'll show you that in a minute, or they can click through to the free claim inquiry and make the inquiry that way. So if you don't have that on your website, you are definitely missing opportunities. The next point, as I've said, once you've got that inquiry form, make sure you flaunt it, put it in the right-hand position, the Amazon Buy Now button. Have it there so that people can click it, go straight through and fill it in. One of the next questions is definitely a key point that often I'm asked, should I put my prices on a web page? And the only answer I can give based on testing again is no, absolutely not. Don't put your prices on your web page. If you do that, you'll be used for comparison. You'll stop getting inquiries. If you offer a fixed fee service, which is competitive, then sell the fact that you offer that fixed fee service. Obviously, give it a unique name that is unique to you that makes me think that sounds brilliant. But then from the website, just sell me to get in touch on the phone with you to find out more about that service. You'll explain what the fee is and how it works, because you need to be speaking to people to sell your service. It is incredibly hard, if not impossible, to sell your full service from a website page. And we'll come on to that in terms of your inquiries now. But that's good advice based on, again, a lot of evidence and one major conveyancing company overnight giving instant quotes and overnight losing every single inquiry, changing back to submitting details and then the solicitor phoning them back and then starting to get more clients. So don't list your prices. Mention a fixed fee service by all means, but get the client on the phone with you to sell that service. That's the way you need to do that. Okay, before we move on to more inquiries, are there any questions you would like to ask at this stage? Anything that's not clear that you'd like clarified? If you've got any questions, fire away and say, don't wait for me to ask you for questions. Type them into the box and I'll be happy to come back to them. There's nothing in there yet, so I will plow on because I know you're busy people and you have work to get back to. So I've just touched on this now, but this really relates to the selling of those high-priced services I mentioned. And the key point is, from your website, the thing that you should be selling and the only thing that you should be selling is the telephone call with you or the first contact with you through the completion of an inquiry form. You should not be trying to sell the whole service or go into details about the provision of that service. You are selling that first contact because the sale will take place when you get me on the telephone or when you start having an email conversation, but telephone usually works better. And I see so many firms trying to sell the whole service and say, right, instruct us now. The last thing I want to see on a website is instruct me now, because there's no way I'm going to instruct a solicitor based on a web page. I'm going to need more proof that you are the right firm for me, and that's going to come through my dealings with you. I've recently had to instruct a conveyancing solicitor. I filled an inquiry form from a website. This is someone I knew who I'd met who lives in Nailsea, where my office is. I've seen him in town, solicitor. I filled in that inquiry form. He sent me an email back. He didn't even relate to the questions I'd asked him about how things work. He's recently merged with another business. Didn't bother responding to that. Sent me his standard quote. Absolutely no chance he was going to get my business because he couldn't be bothered to engage me in a conversation. If he'd have picked up the telephone, had a chat with me, I'm 90% sure he'd have got the work, but he didn't. So the instructions will come from having chats with you. And if people aren't prepared to put the time into that chat, then you are going to miss out. So the point from the website is sell the first contact. From your first contact, if you're selling high-priced hourly rate services, my strong advice is don't try and sell your £200 an hour service. Sell the first part, which is a fixed fee service. So if what you're going to do involves looking at papers, then say, great, well, the first thing I do is either you come in or you don't come in, send me the papers, I'll do a review, and I'll do a fixed price review, go through the legal arguments, tell you what I think your chances are, what I think we should do. And then once you've got that first payment, and I'd use something like GoCardless, so you can take that payment up front, or a card machine, Once you've got a first payment from a stage and they have parted with money, even if it's only £200, £300, £500 for the first stage of that process, it is then so much easier to get them onto your usual hourly rate for your service. If you go straight for, it's £200, £300 an hour, give me £1,000 up front and we'll see how we go. Whoa, 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 that just sounds like a license for you to print money. I don't see any benefit. But if you take the time to sell me stage one, which is giving me some fixed fee advice, you come back with advice which I like. By then we've had a couple of phone calls, an email dialogue. I've built a relationship with you. Now I trust you much more. I'm much more likely to give you that £300 an hour or £200 an hour because you've proved that you know what you're talking about. So I have done this with all sorts of different lawyers, business to business and business to personal, where you're selling an hourly rate service. If you can offer a first stage fixed fee advice, you'll have much more success in selling from your website, because although they are looking for a solicitor and they're motivated to buy, you've still got to take time to woo them a bit. You remember when you used to date, if you said at the first time you met your prospective date or you had a telephone call with someone you were going to go out and see and said, so this is me, this is how I want to see it, this is how I see my life planning out, we're going to have 2.3 children, we're going to live in this house in the Cotswolds, you're going to do this, I'm going to do that, and that will be our relationship, and that's great, you know, we'll live through to 70, 80 and it's going to be wonderful, that's what we're going to do, so should we get married now? You might not be quite so successful. You go out, you get to know each other a bit better. And you pop the question once you know more about the other person. It's the same thing. You have to woo your clients. You have to woo your fixed rate or your hourly rate clients a bit more than you would someone who's just buying a £20 service. You have to spend time building that relationship. So that system is tried and tested and works. If you are selling hourly rate service high priced, offer something fixed fee at the beginning and then sell them onto hourly rate. You know, test that now. You should find it's far more successful than just trying to sell straight into the hourly rate services. In terms of call handling, the comment I wanted to make here is if you are handling all of your calls in-house and they're going through your switchboard, I strongly recommend you test using a call center, because there's two major problems. One is whenever I phone a solicitor's office, rarely do I get the phone answered quickly enough. If I do, I usually get a receptionist who then ask me all sorts of inappropriate questions, particularly if there's three or four offices. Which office do you want to speak to? I don't know. I've got a query about this. Oh, which one do you want? There's this Fiona, that Fiona. Which one do you want? Fiona, what does that mean? And I don't know which one I want. You're supposed to be telling me. If you get a call center handling these inquiries, all they'll do is take the information, they'll have a list of who deals with each type of inquiry, and they'll put you through to that person. So the experience for the customer is much better. Secondly, the thing is, you can give them a separate inquiry form to fill in that immediately goes through to the relevant Fiona, and it allows you to track your return on investment. I'm a strong advocate of this. I've worked with firms that do it in-house and do it out. What happens is firms that generally do it in-house, staff, as I'm sure some of you will know, do not record where the lead comes from. They'll fill it in on your system and they'll just pluck whatever they think is appropriate. A call center, because you're paying them, will ask how they found you, what search term did they type into Google. The client's on the phone in front of their computer, can even look and see what they typed into Google, tells you there and then. You're getting much more intelligence. You're able to track very finely what your return on investment is. So I'm a big, big fan of using a call center. With the cost as little as £30 a month or even less, it will give you a much better return on investment for any money you're spending through your website. You can even have a separate number that goes there and again allows you to track. So if you need help with a call center, just contact me. It's one I use for all of my websites and it works. The next thing is follow up. I had a chat with a firm the other day and I was explaining that, you know, the best firms I've worked with get conversion rates to increase by using hard copy letters to follow up. And this chap, I'm not sure if he's on today, if he is, hi, is an accountant by trade, but manages the marketing for this firm and is a really nice chap, but he was having an accountancy fight with himself, accountancy versus marketing. I'm not sure who's won yet, but I've worked with firms many times over and put in place a letter follow-up. And it improves conversion often by as much as 20 or 30%, because if you are just sending out an email, and many firms aren't even doing that. Think about my conveyancing example earlier. They just sent an email, didn't phone me, couldn't be bothered, didn't follow it up at all, didn't chase up the lead, just left it for me to come back to them. If they'd have picked up the telephone and said, did you get my email, any questions, they might have got me back in. If they'd sent a letter, it would have been another step showing, okay, maybe they are more professional than I thought they were. Your competitors are at most sending an email, and many of them are just having a phone call. Well, good luck, because if it's any matter that I'm going to think about for a few days, by the time it comes back to it, I've probably had another 200-300 emails. I've got to find the email sent to me. If you pop something in the post and no one else has, your details, because so much less comes through the post now, will be on the sideboard. I'll know where to find the letter, pick it up, off I go. You've got the instruction. So big fan of that. So have your call, send an email instantly, send a letter the same day, diarize to follow up 2 or 3 days later with a phone call, and then you can say, you're not selling, but did you get my letter? Any questions? Anything I can help you with? You will get more instructions. You know, and measure it. Do a whole month of the system you use now, and then do a month of following up, including a letter and a follow-up telephone call, and tell me that you don't improve your conversion rate. I'll be amazed. And if you think that your average fee is, say, £500, but you're sending out 20 letters a month, you're very much in profit. So I strongly suggest you give that a go. The final part, more clients automatically. Keep questions coming. We're nearly there, though, so I'll nearly let you get back to your nice sunny afternoons. The final thing I wanted to mention, because I don't think I've done a very good job, is talking about how to get more clients automatically from your website. Whilst lots of Enquiries members have taken advantage of this, others haven't. So I wanted to do a quick run through of why it works. And I am a big fan of anything that gets more people to make inquiries, because if 100 people come to your website and only 2, which is at the best you're likely to get, certainly first claims is 2% or slightly above. Most websites I look at are well below 2%. So 100 people inquire and they're lucky if they get half a person make an inquiry. Who that half person is another thing. So anything that you can do to get more people that visit your site to get in touch with you and begin that process to becoming a client is a huge thing. Live chat can work because it's interactive, and it gets people to tip over the edge from, shall I make an inquiry, shall I come back later, and of course they never do, so it can work really well. But the significant problems with live chat have always been people forget to turn it on, so once the novelty's worn out, you forget to turn it on, so it actually looks like dead chat because it says we're offline now, we're not here, so that looks appalling. Secondly, if you've only got one person accessing it, and you get 2 or 3 questions coming at once, you can't service them, so that doesn't work either. So it has significant problems, and it doesn't also pop up every time you want to use it, so it won't always appear when you want it to. It won't have an interactive element to it. So you may well have seen this picture before, but it's because of you that I created something, and it was literally, yes, they are my feet, sorry. They are my ugly, flat feet. But it was lying on that beach in Barbados last Easter, and I'd had a few days to completely unwind. And I was thinking about you guys and thinking about how I can make your life easier and thinking about the big problem that I can't stand, that, you know, these 100 people come to your website. They are looking for a solicitor. They've typed into Google, I need a solicitor for XYZ. They find your website, and then 98 or 99 or even 99.75 of them leave without taking any action whatsoever. It was sending me mad, and I was thinking, live chat's good, but it doesn't work. And that is when I came up with Your Website Genie, because I created something that I thought, if we could create something that pops up, says, we're here to help, have you got any questions? It would happen automatically. You don't have to log in like live chat, so it will happen 24 hours a day, 365 days of the year. It will pop up, it will generate inquiries for you, and you don't have to do one single thing. Those are the reasons I came up with Your Website Genie, just for you. It was, I promise you, thinking about you and thinking about how I could make your lives easier and how I could get you more clients without you having to do anything, that I came up with the idea for Genie. I came back and said to my business partner, can we do this? Well, this is what I want it to do. And normally he says, oh, Nick, not another idea. And he comes up with a million reasons why we can't do something. He's like, wow, that's a good idea. I like that. I'm sure we can. Let's go off and develop it. 6 months later in September, we launched it. And what amazes me, is that not every single M4S member has bought it. So I don't know why. I wanted to answer any questions you had about it, and I want to convince you to at least give it a test. It's a 30-day money-back test. There's a link from inside the private zone that gets you £5 off a month. It works, very simply. And say it works 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days of the year. You do not have to do one single thing. When it appears, if I go off to it here, when it appears after 30 seconds, and I'll let it do its thing here, hopefully I haven't been here. If you're thinking, one of the common questions is, well, it will annoy people. There's a no button. Once they click no, I don't want to ask a question, it disappears, and it disappears for at least 24 hours until they come out the next day. So it's not over bugging people, and you've seen me turn it off on some of the sites I've been to. But even if you get the odd person, well, I don't like it, just let the figures speak for themselves. If this month you had 10 inquiries on your website, next month you get 15 because you put the genie on there, and you get more clients as a result. Let the extra profits in your bank be the result. Don't let you put yourself testing off this. Just let your clients show you whether they like it or not. So the unobtrusive question pops up. Can we help you? We're here to answer any questions. Yes. Type in the question. And what this does now is it records the page on your website that this question has come from. So even if I don't go ahead and fill in contact details, you will get an email saying, we had a question from this demo page on your website, and it said, help me, Nick. Now, if that's on your website, it says, do you do wills? And they're on a page which is about conveyancing. You realize that, okay, the wills link is perhaps invisible on that page. Why is that? We need to improve that. So you can improve the content on your page and make it convert better. And so it gives you intelligence as well as giving you extra information. If I go on to the next stage of filling in my name, I'm a live lead. I'm someone you can email, and you'll be surprised. Probably half people give their telephone number as well. So you've got a live lead that you can instantly action. When you click send now, you'll get an email. If that's your website, you get an email saying, here's a lead, here's the question, get straight back to them, and you've got a live lead. And the reason, you know, I'm so keen on it is because it's working. And where is my friend Mike? You might have been on Mike's AdWords video. Mike spends all his life working on AdWords, getting more traffic to his website. And he wrote a lovely piece about the genie. And basically, the bottom of it, on the subject of conversion, it works sometimes as much as 3 times better. So if you're getting 10 inquiries a month now, you might get 30 inquiries a month with the genie on there. That would be the exception. But in most cases, it will get you enough extra clients to pay for itself many years over. And you'll see Tony there, who's who's an M4S member. He's also got a genie on his site, and he used Mike's services and had to stop using Mike because he got too much work. So Mike is an AdWords specialist. So, you know, this is someone that knows what he's doing and has said that the genie converts as much as 3 times better. He likes the software. I really like the software, obviously. It's why I created it. But I'd love you to test it. So it's in the private zone. If you've got any questions about that, just let me know now or later. I'm getting to the stage where I'm going to wrap up. So I'd like you to ask me any final questions you want at all, because you know there's more opportunities for you out there. I hope that some things have clicked with you today that perhaps were running around your mind. You weren't quite sure what to do with them. I hope some things have clicked into place. If you have any questions at all, there'll be an exit survey for feedback and any further questions. Fill that in, and I promise I'll get back to you. Or you can ask me by setting up a one-on-one call through the private zone, or you can email me, or you can use the LinkedIn group. But you know, keep talking to me, keep asking questions. I'm here to help you. It's your marketing solicitors. I hope you have found today very useful. I hope you have a great rest of the day and rest of the week. We are, I think, halfway through the year. So if you're not where you want to be yet, it's time now to start doing something so that when you get to the end of the year, you can be having that conversation with your other half or with your business partner and say, wow, we really did it this year. We got to where we wanted to be. Don't wait till December to try and make things improve. Take action now to get you where you want to be at the end of the year. It's the only way you can achieve success. There are plenty of clients out there. If you're not attracting enough yet, you need to do something different. If you need help with what that difference should be, set up a one-on-one call with me from within the private zone and ask me any questions. Thank you for attending today. It's been a pleasure for me. I hope you found it helpful. And I look forward to speaking with you all soon. Thanks very much.